السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، نبينا محمد عليه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم، أما بعد. So today it's part four, and it's the third reason that Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah mentions that will qualify us to receive Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's love. And that is, of course, brothers and sisters, the dhikr or remembrance of Allah jalla wa ala. I mean, we could sit here all day and just talk about what dhikr means to us, how important it is to us. But I want you to just imagine for a moment that your heart is your iman. It's the source of your iman. So sincerity, taqwa, the Quran, the sunnah, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and your love for him, all of that rests in the heart. But the thing about it is throughout the day, throughout the year, throughout our lives, that fluctuates. So we have good days with the Quran, we have not so good days with the Quran. There are days that we'll strive to practice certain elements of the sunnah, and then there are days where we'll struggle with that. And that's just the nature of our faith, is that there are days that are good, there are days that are not so good. Al-Iman yazidu wa yanqus, as our Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam taught us, that iman, it fluctuates. There are good days and there are high points and there are low points. However, with dhikr of Allah, imagine that dhikr of Allah is the rest of your body. And it's the thing that the heart depends on. So it depends on oxygen, blood supply, all of these things, exercise, healthy eating, so that it can stay functional, it can stay stable, and you can have a healthy heart. Without a heart, there is no life. And so when we put all of this together, our faith is our heart, and everything else in our body is the remembrance of Allah Azza wa Jal. It's what fuels our faith. It keeps us consistent. It keeps us focused. So when we talk about the remembrance of Allah, it's not just rituals. It's not just we utter certain phrases or we do certain actions. It's a combination of all of those things. But even more so, it's about maintaining and preserving a connection that is strong and consistent with our Creator subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, when he talks about this particular section, he mentions a lot of different statements from the Salaf, some various ahadith. All I want to do, however, is share with you one particular word in the Quran in Surah Al-Hajj. And this is found in verse number 34. And as a matter of fact, it's at the very end of the verse, one of the last two or three words. وَبَشِّرِ الْمُخْبِتِينَ. And we gave glad tidings to the mukhbitin. Now this particular ayah, before I tell you the translation, this particular ayah was talking to us about the sacrifice that is performed during the Hajj. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala concludes that whole conversation once he talks about certain rulings and ahkam and so on. Allah azza wa jal says, and congratulations or glad tidings to those who are mukhbitin. Mukhbitin comes from the word khabata, and khabata means like a soft ground. You know, when it rains, it softens the mud, and when you walk into it, your foot sinks into it. So that's called mukhbitin. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying is that when we perform a sacrifice for Him, it actually softens our heart. And in addition to that, when people go for Hajj, their lives change, their attitudes change, they soften up, they mellow down. So all of these things fit perfectly. But then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after this particular phrase, وَبَشِّرِ الْمُخْبِتِينَ, the next verse, الَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهُ وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now tells us specifically who are the mukhbitin. They are the ones that are in constant remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, الَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهُ وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ. وَجِلَ, وَجَلٌ, means that it caused their hearts to tremble. They're shaken by the remembrance of Allah. When they say Subhanallah, when they say Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, when they say Alhamdulillah, when they just utter phrases that remind them of their Creator, it's not just they're saying it, their heart is speaking as well. You know, their mind is focused. And Ibn al-Qayyim, of course, mentions the three main categories of how we remember Allah: with our tongue, with our heart, and with our limbs. So of course, with our tongue, everything that we say and do and recite and so on, our du'as, our adhkar, the Qur'an, and so on. Our heart, if we're not reciting, our heart is still constantly remembering, thinking, reflecting, and keeping connected with our Creator. And of course, the body. If the heart is not there, if the tongue is not there, then at least you're helping, you're doing things, you're making lives, you're making life better for you and for the people around you. You're actually engaged and you're doing something, you're praying, you're in ruku', you're going in sajda, you're raising your hands. All of these actions, they actually count in the sight of Allah that you're remembering Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. When somebody raises their hands and they make dua to Allah, just the action of raising their hands, Allah calls this a dhikr. You're remembering me. Because why? You're raising your hands for Him. So that counts as something. You know, it's just like when you're called to do a task, you have to get ready, get dressed, you leave your home, you drive, you walk, you got to get to a place and perform a certain job. But most jobs will only pay you, will only give you some compensation, give you some reward when you're actually at the job site and you perform the jobs that you're required to do, and that's it. But from when you wake up, when you get dressed, when you leave your home, when you transport and when you travel and you go where you need to be, none of those things count. But to Allah, it does. When you wake up and you do all of those things in your routine, they still count for remembrance. So the point is, brothers and sisters, what I'm trying to get at when we're talking about remembrance, you notice that I'm not telling you, okay, do A, B, and C, and you're going to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Make the remembrance of Allah personal. Find your place when it comes to these adhkar. Find areas within remembrances and phrases and a routine that works for you. Because why? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam tells us about Allah azza wa jal that Allah loves that which is consistent. So to develop some sense of consistency, you have to find your comfort zone when it comes to the remembrance of Allah. But the point is, you got to find that. You can't just be, you know, at ease with your situation that, okay, I only remember Allah on particular days, on a particular night, or in certain occasions or certain times of the year. It's not going to work. This is where you develop this very skewed, incomplete relationship with your Creator. It won't make any sense. There will be times where you're often questioning, why am I even doing this? Why am I keep saying the same phrases over and over? Why do I have to keep bowing down and going to sajda? Why do I have to keep doing all of these things? Why? Because it doesn't become meaningful. When you really put your heart into it and you start off with the things that are comfortable and easy for you, and this is, of course, part of our prophetic tradition. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helps by adding barakah and layers to that. So for example, you start reciting one of your favorite surahs. Okay, so let's say Surah Yasin or Surah Ar-Rahman. You start off with one of your favorite surahs of the Quran. And you're reading this and then you go into the translation and you start studying a little bit of its meaning. Before you know it, I promise you, inshallah, this is going to happen to you. I promise you, inshallah ta'ala. When you start off with any simple surah or hadith or anything that connects you with Allah and you do it properly, your thirst, your hunger, your desire of wanting to learn more will start to increase. It will intensify and you will be like, I don't know where this is coming from, but it's the best feeling in the world. And you'll just want more and more. How do you think those who memorize the Quran, how do you think they do that? They don't just jump right into it and start memorizing all over the place. They take one surah at a time, one page at a time, one line at a time. But that desire, that discipline, it continues to increase. That's what the remembrance of Allah should do for all of us. It's not just a straight road, but it's a road that we continue climbing. And every time you do it and you develop yourself, you continue to climb higher and higher and higher. And what's at the top of the mountain? It's Allah Azza wa Jal. It's the Jannah. It's the paradise. It's where we want to be. But the point is, is you feed yourself with that spiritual energy of remembrances and adhkar of Allah Jalla wa Ala. This is what Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah mentions in his book, that once you do this, the mahabba of Allah Jalla wa Ala, the love and acceptance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will begin to develop and it will intensify, and before you know it, you're going to see adhkar in everything you do. And this is the last thing that I'll mention. The way that you train your body and your mind and your soul to constantly be in the remembrance, there's definitely one thing that has to be part of that picture, and that is you have a consistent daily relationship in recitation of the Quran. And I've mentioned this many times in previous videos. The recitation of the Quran, and the reason why I stress on this so much, is it's the one thing that all of us have to start with. You know, many people, when they want to criticize the religion, when they want to criticize, you know, scholars, and they want to say this and that and have their own interpretation of what they think Islam should mean for them, very often people who do that don't have a consistent recitation relationship with the Quran. As a matter of fact, a lot of them that I meet, they don't even know how to read the Quran. They can barely scrape by with Surah Al-Fatiha. I've even met some Muslims that have only memorized Surah Al-Fatiha and Surah Al-Ikhlas, nothing else. And they just kind of repeat it every single salah. And that's just their whole relationship with Allah. See, the point with the problem with that is you're not trying. You're not trying to dive in deeper in this book. And so as a result, the remembrances, they're going to be, these empty fluff type remembrances. Like, they're not going to mean anything. You're just going to be saying, Subhanallah, La ilaha illallah, La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. And it wouldn't do anything. It won't move you. Your heart will still be pumping at the same rate. You'll just be sitting there. And, you know, life would start to feel meaningless. And as a matter of fact, when you have that kind of relationship, all the things that you're not supposed to be engaged with, you shouldn't participate in, or you shouldn't be doing, they will start to become attractive. This is what happens. The blood supply, the spiritual supply to your heart, to your iman, is weak. So it can't pump out the strength and consistency that you need to remain focused. So now when you hear a song, when you watch a movie, and you see those like certain scenes that show up in the movie, you're supposed to press the fast forward button, or you're supposed to watch something else. But then you tell yourself, it's just only 2 seconds, it's not a big deal. They don't show everything. People who talk like that, their approach to things like that in life in general, these are people that are struggling with the remembrance of Allah. And finally, brothers and sisters, without adhkar, regular and consistent remembrance, without doing things and keeping ourselves within a model that helps us to remain consistent in our remembrance, we will lose that spirit, that sacredness, that the experience that we all want, which is when you hear the Quran, you start feeling a bit emotional. If you're praying behind an imam, you don't even understand the Quran, but it's still moving you. You start to feel like a tear come down, and you're like, you don't even know what surah he's reciting, let alone the meaning. But why? It's because you have this constant relationship with your Creator. Allah softens your heart, softens it more and more. وَبَشِّرِ الْمُخْبِتِينَ. And you know what's the most amazing thing about that? It's the long-term outcome. When you soften your heart with the remembrance of Allah, then your heart is softened with people, with experiences. You're able to tolerate a lot. You're patient. You can forgive. You can forget. You can move on. You can put the awful things behind you. And if they confront you know how to deal it in a civilized way. That's what the remembrance of Allah does. It keeps us under control. It keeps us stable. But more importantly, it keeps us connected with our Creator. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always and forever preserve and protect the remembrance of Allah in our hearts and in our lives. Allahumma ameen. Jazakum Allahu khairan, everyone. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless all of you wherever you are, keep you safe and keep you healthy. Allahumma ameen. Jazakum Allahu khairan, everybody. Until we meet again, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.